Okay. Great. Okay. So thanks very much. I just want to say thanks so much for allowing me to talk. We've put lots of work into building the genomics virtual lab. And it's very encouraging for us when other people get their show interest. So thank you. So the genomics virtual lab is essentially a government or Australian government funded platform for genomics. It's actually a little broader than Galaxy, but Galaxy is the main platform that we aim to provide to researchers. Importantly, it's built on a federal investment in the cloud for researchers here in Australia. So that's Future of Australia. And about 4 years ago, the Australian government committed around about $100 million to building a large distributed OpenStack-based cloud to be available for all Australian researchers, so not just for biology or genomics researchers, for all researchers. So $100 million gets you around about, got us around about 30,000 cores and some petabytes of storage implemented in multiple zones around Australia, and then basically these green little cloud icons here correlate with the major cities in Australia. So each zone has somewhere between sort of 2,000 and 6,000 or 7,000 cores. In aggregate, it's a very significant cloud. And of course, for the researcher, it's fantastic because it's free. So it's built on pretty good hardware, and it doesn't cost per hour. It's actually on a merit allocation basis. So this was the driver for building various platforms for virtual laboratories for the different sciences. And one of those sciences was biology. And so significant money went into building the genomics virtual lab to work on this cloud. Okay, I should say that about 2/3 of the way through our installation of the Australian Research Cloud, Amazon came to Australia and implemented a very large data centre in Sydney. So there are effectively two sort of large cloud providers in Australia now, the Research Cloud provided by the government and Amazon. Okay. So to build the genomics virtual lab, we thought about what you need in order to do genomics on the cloud, and this is what we have come up with, and I'm pretty sure it's probably similar to what you guys are providing as well. Essentially, you need some sort of large server or a cluster underneath with numerous analysis tools. Large storage, so the data sets in genomics are very big. They're very big on a per-user basis, and that's different from some sciences where you have sort of large centralized data sets. Here, each user brings large data sets to the table for analysis, and that has challenges. And we're aiming to provide multiple analysis platforms and around these sort of three areas. The first is obviously a workflow, a graphical workflow engine, and Galaxy is obviously intended for that. But we also see a lot of demand for statistical and computational work platforms for analysis. So our genomics virtual lab attempts to provide all of these platforms and we haven't achieved it yet to allow sort of common data access across all those. And quite critically, the bottom layer access to reference data. You can't do genomics without having large pre-indexed databases of genomes. And the larger your candidate audience that you're trying to make happy, the larger the number of indexed genomes that you need for people to map their genomic data against. So that's really the set of things that we think that we need to provide in order to give people an effective research platform, training research platform. Okay, so in practice, there's three parts to the genomics virtual lab. We have online tutorials and protocols, and it's not trivial to develop those. And by protocols, it's workflows and the implementation of that in Galaxy. We have managed services, and that's essentially public servers for Galaxy and also for Miro, the UCS genome browser. Different institutes have implemented their own managed services in Galaxy, so we don't have one Galaxy for Australia. And I'll talk about why that is in a little further. connected. And last of all, we have this concept of the Genomics Virtual Lab Workbench, which is this computational engine built on the cloud that provides Galaxy and RStudio and the iPython computational sort of workbench or studio, I guess. And that's launchable on the cloud and manageable on the cloud. So you can launch a small one and then build it into a big one by adding nodes. So there's sort of three areas of the GDL in practice, and of course, we've tried to align and balance the nomenclature of get, use, and learn. And I did a, I'm going to talk mostly about the GDL workbench, but I did a quick mapping against the overview from the Victoria Galaxy project, and of course, I think it maps pretty well. Yeah. So we have the get, where users can go and launch their own, although yours is a little more ambitious now, so if you're looking for both cloud and PC or server. The use, where you're doing your own public service, providing them to different research communities, and of course, learn, which is doing a manual and tutorials, workflows, and whatnot for people to use to do their job. So that's a nice convergence. We're trying to do the same thing and come to the same conclusions about how to get there, I think. So the GDL workbench is actually the basis for our managed Galaxy services as well. We build a large workbench and then we manage it on behalf of a research institute. But in fact, the idea is that users can go and launch their own genomics virtual lab workbenches if they want, and what we're trying to make here is a web-based sort of workbench for doing genomics with access to many tools on a scalable back-end, with fast access to the reference genomes that I talked about earlier, which users can manage on their own and configure on their own and tools do on their own and log into on their own. Multiple modes of interaction, that is, have a workflow, we have a statistical studio, we have a computational studio in the iPython notebook, and users can secure shell into it themselves, they can log directly in the command line. We of course want to make this finally available and accessible with a very low cost of entry for the user to make it very easy for the user to go and launch their own and enter the analysis rather than having to do a lot of work to get it working. That's a big challenge, so we spend a lot of time doing that. You might ask, I'll get to that in a minute, why don't we just, and you guys have probably thought about this as well, why don't we just provide a big sort of managed Galaxy for everybody? And in theory, that's very admirable sort of objective, I guess, and my humorous picture here is that the objective of any sort of managed service is that it's like a rocket truck, and that you want to have enormous performance available all the time, but the reality is often more like this shortly after implementing that. So you build what you think is an extremely large, powerful sort of managed service for many users, and then shortly becomes very, very, very bogged down, not just in people doing the computation, but actually the first sort of hurdle that you get is data. People putting all of their data on your managed service and getting a little irate if you want to take their data off. So that's quite a challenge, and it actually directs the strategy of the genomics virtual lab to some extent, and maybe your strategy as well from what I saw in your overview diagram here at Pitagora. So our philosophy here is that many people with their own little analysis workbench is better than one great big one which is bogged down. And what we would like to do is allow people to essentially provide their own resources, their own computational resources, and then build their own platform of whatever size they want from that. But we do recognise that we also need to provide some managed, some public services. Okay. So what I'd like to do now is to give you a demo of building a GDL, a genomics virtual lab, and just show the sorts of services that we offer and how they integrate together. So I've got quite a lot of slides here, but I'm not going to go through them all. Some of them are quite technical. What I'll do is actually get the demo running and then address the slides if I need them. So we have a very simple way, we think, of launching or someone being able to launch their own computational workbench, and that is through a website, a launching website. I'll make it bigger. which takes a minimum amount of information. And what it basically takes is what cloud do you want to launch this on? And we have multiple clouds up there, and one of our ambitions has always been to make our genomics virtual lab cloud agnostic. That means we can launch it on Amazon, or we can launch it on the Nectar Research Cloud, which is open stack based. And there are various technical challenges that go around with that. Provide their credentials for that cloud and a little bit of information that we need to track users so that we can report on grants and whatnot, report our success stories on grants. Give it a name, I'll build one right now. And put in a password so I can access it later. I have multiple options for the instance types. Our OpenStack Research Cloud supports 2, 4, and 8 core instances, but of course, if it was Amazon, you'd have the option to Amazon gives you. And that's how many you have to put in, if that's the minimum that you need to put in, and that's sufficient to go into a GDL. There are more advanced options. One of the advanced options is where would you like to build this and what zone. We have multiple zones in Australia, as I showed on that map. I'm going to put it in one particular zone that I know is very responsive. Different zones sometimes respond to different performances. And this is a reported one, so I'm pointing at the screen, you can't see me, I'm just doing this instead. You should be able to select the actual image that you're after. And the idea of that, of course, is that once you've created one of these and done some work on it, you'd like to be able to create it again and do the same work on it at some stage, and that's the essence of reproducibility. If you can't do that, then you're in trouble. And of course, Galaxy changes every few months, and it changes significantly every 6 months. So we keep track, we keep historical set of images so that people can launch their own galaxies. Okay, and that's there's a last menu item we'll play down here, and if I get time, I'll talk about what that means a bit later on. But if that should be sufficient, I'll just check I've got everything in there correct. And I should be able to click on Start Instance. And with a little bit of luck, that will go off and requisition very quickly, only a small instance, in this case a 2-core virtual machine, and then it will implement on that the base image for the genomics virtual lab, which is an Ubuntu image with some nice sort of, we'll call them generic services that allow for easy access. So we haven't actually installed our analysis services yet, that will come in a little while. What we're doing now is building the base image that will give us the management requirements that we need. Okay, so that was happily extremely quick, 37 seconds. We've got our image up and information on what its IP is and whatnot and how we can get access to it. We'll make that a little bigger so everyone can see it. And I just can click on this now, and it takes me to this dashboard, which shows me what services are offered on this workbench. And you'll see that there's a number of options, including Galaxy and iPython Notebook and RStudio. Some of those aren't working yet, so there's a bit of extra work to do to start things that I want. The most important service at the moment is this manager service, which is CloudMan, and this was developed by Ennis Afghan, who's one of the developers of the Galaxy project. So true to form, green demos, this should have popped up, but it hasn't popped up just yet, so there we go. This gives me the option of asking, what do you want to build here? I want a Galaxy cluster, and if I wanted to, I could attach a 2 or 3 terabyte volume to that. Yep.
I'll go back.
See that hand up there?
Can you zoom the screen a little bit? Yes, much better.
Okay. So I'll get the option here, and this is important, right? So I can start one of these up with whatever data resources I'm having or I have ownership of effectively in that cloud. And with Amazon, that's whatever I'm paying to pay for. So this goes to requisitions, volume and size, 1 gigabyte through to, or whatever the limit is. For our cloud, it seems to be unlimited. You can go and get 50 terabyte if you want, and it'll match that. I can also just use the transient storage that comes with that. Our virtual machine, and that's what we're going to do at the moment. And what this is doing now is going and building the application layer on top of the base image layer. So this is going and downloading a pre-configured and pre-built Galaxy file system, database, all the tools, everything. It downloads that and extracts it onto that volume that I created for. And once that's done, it's downloaded and extracted it. The CloudMan application, which is what we're looking at now, has the intelligence to be able to manage that Galaxy service. So it has the intelligence to be able to start up the database, start up Galaxy, start up all the other prerequisites. It's also installing a Sloan manager, a job manager underneath, and telling Galaxy to connect to the Sloan cluster manager or job manager. So it takes 3 or 4 minutes to do that. Download the files and extract it and then sort of start it if you like. Then I've got an admin tab here which allows me to monitor what's going on, and I can sort of see here the various services that were not being started up and the things that are running at the moment. So I've created the Galaxy volume. I haven't been part of the Galaxy application yet. Sunbury Engine is actually an older version, so it's running Sunbury rather than Sloan. Sunbury Engine is starting, and it says started, Postgres database, FTP daemon and whatnot will be started. And I can manage those things through this page. Okay. So as that starts up services, the status of these services will update the dashboard. At the moment it's gone from a dash to a cross. And the meaning of that is that it's recognised that the correct directory is created and the service is up and running. So that will change to a nice green icon, meaning the Galaxy is running. While it's doing that, in the background, I can start up another sort of interaction service. And this is a really nice thing that we just added last year. It's a VNC desktop that you can access with the browser. So I can log on to this to my instance. It's just been created, and obviously the first thing that happens when you start a new version, new instance of Linux, it tells you you need to upgrade. So here I have my instance that I just created, and I have what many people like to see when they create an instance, which desktop, and this is the desktop for that instance, and I can start a terminal in here, and you probably can't see what I'm doing, but I'm just looking at my directory at the moment, and it's actually quite a nice way of getting a command line interface in a browser very, very easily. So that's appreciated by people who perhaps aren't technically familiar with things as we might be. So I can go to my dashboard and see if things are updated. Obviously the Galaxy is now running. So that's, if I go to my CloudMan admin page, I'll see that it's starting up all these services and it's monitoring to make sure they're all okay. The next thing I'm going to do is actually start up this thing we call Journey Virtual Lab Utilities. And what this does is it creates links to Galaxy tools on the command line, so that any of the tools that are able to talk to Galaxy are also used from the command line. It also has RStudio and iPython. And then go back to my dashboard, and I should see everything running now. So all the things are up and running. Click any of these now. And now I have a blank essentially Galaxy which I can log into or I can make available to my users. You've all seen Galaxy, so you all know what Galaxy looks like. Importantly, this is pre-configured with a lot of stuff. So there's a lot of tools in here and they all work. So a lot of energy goes into managing the build of this Galaxy and then making sure that it works. Not just in and of itself, but it works with all of the tutorials and the workflows that we have as part of our learn. As I said, when we try to provide the broader set of analysis engines, if you like, that Galaxy, we have for instance, iOS at the moment, which many of you may have used. And this is a really powerful way of interacting computationally with our data. Obviously, sort of write a little bit of code here, and what like a nice graphs in an interactive way, and in a reproducible way as well. And I can actually get access to the Galaxy data through the iPython at the moment. And then the last service is RStudio, in an extremely widely used service amongst the researchers.
Because I want to get to just the engineering, I guess, what's required to make that happen.
back to the overview of the Pythagorean galaxy again, because I really like to talk about some of our experiences in doing this work. And these things that I've written in red here, they really are a lot of work, and probably much more than we considered they were going to be when we started this project. So getting everything to work together and all the dependencies of the image once is a lot of work. Everything is a moving target. So galaxy is changing, platform is changing, and very challenging to build the infrastructure required in order to be able to sort of update things in a structured way. It's a lot of manual work. You don't want to do it manually. Ideally, you would have an automated method building all the bits that you assemble in your vertical platform. And adding in new sort of workflows and tutorials is not trivial at all either. It depends on everything you've done over here. So if you change something over here, then often your workflows don't work anymore because they have a specific tool in them that you don't have anymore, etc., etc. So these things really are a lot of work. But the beautiful part of genomic virtual is building the components that we then assemble in that runtime is where a huge amount of work has gone into, and we've just actually moved everything to an Ansible build system. So we have a label called the PDF label, and this is essentially a very, very lengthy label which has two parts. You build the base, you run the unit with all the dependencies as well as other services like the desktop of the browser and whatnot. I demonstrated before, and a separate one to build an entire galaxy file system on top of that and save it. And this is, again, quite a challenging thing to do. It goes down to the tool shed, tries to make sure everything works together, makes all the dependencies as sort of the underlying image. And the idea is that then we then have multiple. So it's taken us a great deal of time to get all the information that is available in this playbook, this Ansible playbook, working, and it now does work. So we almost automated process of generating the things that we need in order to go and do this bit here. In terms of practice, what we actually recommend people using the genomics virtual lab is they sort of think about it in three different ways. You can build a little personal GDL if you like, it's just got a small number of cores, and that's very useful for training. We use that very, very often. It doesn't have any data storage requirement, it just uses the volume storage that comes with the virtual machine. So it's essentially a transient genomic virtual lab. If you manage your own galaxy and your own analysis environment, then you go and use server GDL, and that's essentially between 8 and 64 cores with a handful of terabytes of volume storage. And if you're an institute, and we have a number of these now, and that you would be looking at sort of into 100 cores, it's quite common for an institute to have a 50 terabyte database underlying that. And when you get to this scale, something's in the cloud chain. So networking, and whatnot, they start to have effect. So things don't just keep sales. Sort of fine around here, but NFS, if you've got many, many nodes in your cluster, NFS does have issues, does start to have problems. Galaxy by default, and I've got a virtual lab start with its own NFS server, that works up to a point that you need to start thinking of something a bit more, but like why not for a bit more planning. So today we've actually installed 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 large genomics virtual lab instances. These are the servers, I guess. And these are, as I said, 50 to 100 cores with 50 terabytes underneath. And they require someone to manage them. So you have to have someone there managing this thing to keep it running for everything. Yep. So some of the lessons that we've learned past year is that actually defining and maintaining instead of what is good is actually very challenging, much more challenging than what it would be. Just defining and finding that and on their audience can have some things are obvious, like being a good way, or not. But defining what the visions are, you know, self, and that's actually self. Providing confidence is really challenging. It gets more challenging as more users start doing more stuff with bigger data. The cloud runs out of the loop if something. Not all private cloud nodes and people. I don't understand what that is, but I guess it's internal condition teams or something. Sometimes some cloud completely unperformant. That's a very hard. Geography matters, so Australia is a big country geographically, and to be able to move data from cities at limited bandwidth. So you have to build something where the data is. That's what the cloud should be used for anyway. Resourcing has been a real driver, as in what can we take resources and provide it by who? So we can't provide infinite data and computers to researchers, and really, I guess we wish institutes to take responsibility for providing those resources out to people. Yeah, as building the layout can be brought to the table. So in summary, I guess we it's the Jennings virtual brand always on the training platform, and it works very, very well. We use it as a research analysis platform, but it's not trivial to do that and do a big, you know, galaxy and make some effort into it. It's actually something I'm thinking is very useful is that it's a standard tool development business platform that has been really, really useful. So people can develop tools on computer data in the knowledge platform. And it's actually enabled us to start up really good applications across the world, including the Broad Institute of the Galaxy based, the European Population, General Analysis Centre, and Nottingham Universities. And that's been a real plus for us because I think today we're an academic institute, much like you guys, and some of the others, and the performance entries are around who are you paying the vision. And what collaboration that we get. Okay, so what I quickly want to say is what's next for the Jones Virtual Laboratory project. We still have a huge amount of problem moving data around in Galaxy, getting it back off Galaxy, getting people to move their data off Galaxy, the Genomics Virtual Lab. And we've been pursuing, we'd like to remove the desktop and USB drives from the whole process. That hasn't happened yet, but we've been looking at this, this platform that the Broad Institute has developed in Genomes, and it's actually a portal to cloud data, cloud application. And we've adapted this to OpenStack now, since cloud is based on, and I think this might be something that we push researchers more and more forward to get their data on the cloud and worry about computation. Later on, so we don't keep getting sent hard calls. Okay, so there's a lot of people who have been involved in this. We've been going for 3 or 4 years now. I think we've reached some technical maturity platform use, and we are sort of getting more interesting problems now around how we go to resource the data and the storage that underlies. And I'll stop there and take it.
Thank you.